called 108, which is the national emergency service provider, and said, look, there's an accident here, you got to help. They said, where are you? Guess what? We are clueless. We are driving from Hyderabad to Warangal, we are clueless. We open a Google map, zoom it out, there's a long road, no landmarks. What do I describe to somebody? So we hung up the phone. And then it struck us 5 minutes later that, yeah, we have a clue. We looked at the toll gate that we paid, 6:47 a.m. Okay, now is the time. Average calculation of speed and said, look, this is the point at which we could have probably had this accident. So go and figure it out, right? So 108 was helpful. They went, and I don't know what happened after that. But the patient that we took them to a hospital. And at the hospital, we found it takes 20 minutes to organize everything and get everything arranged for care to happen. Fine. We thought we were very thoughtful citizens. We went around and said, what do you need to make this happen? They said, we want blood, we want this, we want that. And they're clueless. Warangal is not an area I know. I've not grown up there. I have no idea what to do. And I gave the person to the other people, signed a couple of documents, and I'm out. Right? While coming back, my journey started. In the journey, I figured out that I have to go and talk and sit in a call center where 108 happens. Right? I went to call center, sat to the call center. In the call center, for the first time, I discovered how wide India is in terms of diversity. Okay? The incoming calls in Telugu, I can't even understand that's Telugu. That's my mother tongue. Because there are close to about 10 different slangs. And the other person is trying to describe an address. And the description of address is a funny thing in India, right? You have a temple, yellow gate, banyan tree, a cigarette shop. I don't know how the people can navigate to that location so urgently. So location was definitely a problem to solve in the case of emergency. I thought, okay, great, location solved, everything solved. Let me understand more. I went to the hospitals, revisited them and said, look, what do I need to do to help you be more productive in an emergency? Number one, they said, all accidents, deaths happen, loss of blood. Period. Trauma, accidents happen, loss of blood is the number one problem. So how do I get blood? And in a place like Chennai, Hyderabad, I'm sure there are blood banks which will step up and do. Just go 25 kilometers away from Chennai, 50 kilometers away from Hyderabad. You have no blood bank. So pretty much the person is on himself. That's when this aha moment happened to me, saying that, look, in health, what is very important to recognize is I or my family cares about me. Rest all in the ecosystem can step up their efforts, but they don't, they're numb, they're a little bit numb. They are seeing so many accidents, they are seeing so many things on an everyday basis that it is me and my family can step up, right? Then I go back and ask people. I should tell you an interesting story. As I was doing this research, one of my IIT friends called me and said, hey, I see these videos of yours about a bunch of activities in emergency. I want to ask a question. My dad had a heart attack. He fell in my lap. He was just sitting there. I was calling ambulance and a bunch of these things. And by the time they turned up, I know he passed away. I'm seeing your videos. I realized that if I had done CPR, there was a chance of success. What do you think? The question he asked me. And I said, what is the intention of asking this question? Are you going to feel more guilt-trip in life? And he said, he answered me saying that I know what your answer is. The point is, how many of us in this room have learned CPR? 5 hands here. So CPR can save lives, right? Similarly, one step further out, there's an AED, a concept of AED, where there's an electronic defibrillator that you can use on a chest and can revive the heart. India has no idea. Imagine somebody has a heart attack here. Right now, in this place, we have no clue around this place where an AED is. We have no idea. And how do we look at that? At that moment of emergency, as you all know very well, your intelligence doesn't work in emergency. It's only the training and memory that can be of some help. Your mind is going to be numb and doesn't work. So you need a simple tool which you're already trained to do to enable an emergency reaction. So that brings home to what I do as a company. We as a company, we build a platform called Call Ambulance. And the idea of Call Ambulance is that we did a research and said, what do you want to think of in your emergency? And everybody said ambulance. So we had to put some ambulance in our company's name called Call Ambulance. Okay, that's the story. But essentially what we're doing to do is that we're looking at entire emergency integration. A first responder coming to the house, an ambulance coming and picking up, identifying the right hospital to go to. In the event of cardiac, we need to go to a hospital that has cath lab. In the event of trauma, we need to go to a hospital that has a CT scanner. Like that, we have an ecosystem built out. That's where they have to go to. In that doctor, that particular hospital, even though they put a nice board called 24/7, that doesn't mean 24/7. It means that after you go to the hospital, they will say, hello doctor, some patient is here, please come back here. Then the doctor will rush. How can I enable this to happen faster? So the patient is in the ambulance, the doctor knows there's an inbound ambulance coming in. If I can set up this infrastructure in place, then the scalability of that is multiplication effect. Today, we don't have that infrastructure. What we have with 108 is they have done an outstanding job. They have done an outstanding job, but they do only ambulance providing. The remaining parts of the ecosystem is missing. And the problem is very huge and magnitude. I'll give you numbers for you to understand. Every 4 minutes, there's a road death in India. I thought that was really bad, really sad. Now comes an even more hard task, which is every minute there's a cardiac arrest and somebody's died. Every minute, as I count in the speech, there are so many people dead there on cardiac. And guess what? The survival rate of cardiac is only 1%. Out of every 100 patients who have cardiac arrest, 1% survives. So it's pretty bleak situation as to what we can do. And that's the reason this platform has been built with all the integration points, so that we can get the collaboration to happen in real time. So at Hyderabad, where we are right now placed, we have integrated about 60 plus hospitals, 120 plus ambulance vans, private ambulances. We have integrated public provider 108 into our system. We have also got people getting trained in first response. So we train first response. And they're so simple techniques that all of us, you see it one time, you know it. I'll give an example. After I got trained, we had another accident witness on the road. I mean, these days you can do pretty much every day, you can see it. A person got badly injured. All that you have to do is make sure they lift the arm above the heart level, so the loss of blood is lower. Just simple physics principle. But that can be taught. Once you teach it, somebody will learn it. So it's a 4-hour program we run called First Response Program, and we get corporate hospitals to actually do it. At corporates, drivers, etc. So we're doing that stuff. Now we have taken this one step further. We have a pilot going on in one district near Vizag, where the entire district is going to collectors hyper enthusiastic. We need such passionate people. So they are helping us onboard the entire ecosystem onto that platform. So that enables the district to go first time as the first mobile enabled emergency city in the country today. So that's really where we're going towards that. I want to take one step further as to what opportunity we have looking at from that use case. And this is something that I want to make a mention on. And this is something close to my heart, so you know, give me some slack here. See, basically we develop a lot of great solutions. And we try to push it to citizens. That doesn't work. You want a demand structure from citizens. Citizens should say, I want this. So it's a principle where you take a donkey to the riverfront and expect it to drink water. It doesn't want to. So all the initiatives that we have done on digital health, whether it's a Google Health, whether it's a Microsoft Vault, all of these things are somebody pushing it out to the citizen. It doesn't work. What the citizen wants is a single use case on which his digital records that are stored in his mobile, stored somewhere else, are used by somebody else. How many of you have digital records which your doctor is using? No, hardly anybody. So if the other end is not consuming the digital record, the citizen is not empowered to use it. There comes the demonetization principle. Prior to demonetization, what happened is there is a middleman. We call him a banker. All the great well-wishers, no malefic interest, but still is a middleman who will say, hey, come to me, I will give you money. With the demonetization, what's happening is you're putting the power back in the hands of the person. When you put the power back in the hands of the person, it makes a difference. They start demanding it. They say, I want this in Tamil, I want this in Telugu, I want this in Marathi. And until you do that, that demand doesn't happen. So that's what we want to do in healthcare. We are giving this power in the hands of the consumer so they start demanding things. And when they start demanding things, the ecosystem comes and makes this happen. And that is what we want to do. So what we are doing in emergency case is seeding a digital record in the eyes of the consumer to make a change happen. Right? Now, I'll take it one step further. When we're having this empowerment happen with the consumer, he's putting in their emergency record. all of you take a 5 seconds and think about your own family. What is that digital record you will put for your mom, dad, sister, brother, son, daughter, whatever, right? You will put their most pressing medical problem, because your hypothesis in your mind is the emergency is going to emanate from that particular problem. People have put on my record some dental issue. Dental issue? That was my first reaction. But then you read to the issue, you realize that they have a serious dental problem. They anticipate a big emergency from dental issue, right? So what now happens is a consumer is putting their most pressing health problem on the platform. What does that do to my platform? I can now target education. If a pregnant lady is putting her most pressing problem to be pregnancy and second month pregnancy, then I can actually target her second month pregnancy education. I could do that similarly on a 9th month pregnancy education, which is entirely different from a second month. And if a newborn is born and they say I expect an emergency for the newborn, I will know that, okay, this kid was born on X date. How can I engage this person in education on infant care? So that seeding of digital record in the hands of the consumer is the fundamental change on which AI, ML, deep learning, you name any other technology, can be built further. If that seed is not there in the consumer's hand, it doesn't matter. It doesn't work. So that is what we are trying to do as a digital revolution. We are seeding it in the hands of consumer so that they have the power in their hands. And once that is happening, you can do all kind of education, all kind of stuff for the person. So that's the journey we're going in. So we feel that we are very privileged to work with a couple of IITians. IIT Madras, I have a team of bunch of guys from IIT Madras and ex-colleagues from Infosys. So that way we have built a good team. Now we are implementing it district by district in many places. So hopefully we'll come to Chennai one day. Any questions you have, I can take. Is that the procedure? Yeah. If any questions are there, I can take. Excellent question. There are standards Government of India is trying to define, but it's not defined yet. We don't have a particular standard, but we have chosen the global standard. There's some concepts called HL7, which is available in the US. We use that standard. But I want to take a moment on that standard itself. I think the concept of standard may become irrelevant in a couple of years' time with the way AI is developing. See, the AI is able to read an unstructured data from your Facebook and make conclusions about what's going on there. So what is the point of having a data standard? The idea of data standard is going through a tremendous transformation with AI coming in. It actually will put the whole concept on its head in 2-3 years time frame. Yeah, no, I understand. I'm denying that, but I'm just saying the whole idea of standardization is going through a very transformative thing with AI coming into play. Hospitals, with outstanding respect, I'm saying this, hospitals are first business houses. Okay? We have to recognize that. So when we recognize the outside aspect that the hospitals are businesses, no business will like to give away their information to somebody else. So there is an inherent mental block for them to get started. It's not a question of technology, it's not a question of anything else. The inherent mental block. So if that were to transcend, a regulation is required. That's the regulation that happened in the United States in 2008, and it took about 7-10 years for them, for that sharing of records to happen. But once we recognize that the hospitals are businesses in the first place, then I think we need to revisit whether that assumption is going to be valid.
Thank you so much, Mr. Umashankar. Sorry, can you take this question offline, because we are running out of time? Sure. Thank you so much, Mr. Umashankar, and this has been an extremely interesting Thank you. Our next speaker is Mr. Ajit Narayan. Mr. Ajit Narayan is the founder and CEO of Aavaaz Inc. Aavaaz is an app which helps kids with autism and other disabilities to develop language and communication. Please give him a warm welcome.